Here it is, Rome. Rome in the first century. I don't know if you know this, but in the first century, Rome's seat of power, where Caesar ruled from, was called Capitoline Hill. Capitoline Hill. And the temple of Juno Monita was a part of Capitoline Hill. Juno Monita, which is where we get Juno, Alaska. Juno Monita. Not realizing when you see the President of the United States up on the hill, this is all Rome. Okay. Yeah, domes. Domes are very important. The word dome comes from a Latin word, domus. Domus gives us domesticated, dominate, Dominican Republic, domineering, domus. Domus meaning the presence of the divine. Domus. The presence of God, the presence of divine. Domus. And you'll find domes everywhere. Churches have domes. Religious buildings incorporate a dome. The Vatican, dome. St. Peter's, domus. Here we have from a publication showing Jesus giving the keys to Peter, the keys of heaven, the two keys. And you will see in the back the Vatican. Domus. So Jesus is giving the keys to Peter. The United States government has the same identical dome as the one in Vatican. Identical. It's because this government is dominated by international maritime admiralty law, the law of international banks. International maritime admiralty law is based on Vatican canon law. Vatican canon law is the law of banks and money. And consequently, that's why the Pope has a Swiss guard. Switzerland is the bankers of the world. Consequently, you need to understand what these symbols mean. Let's see if there's something else on here. No. Yeah, there it is, a mortarboard derived from a cap worn by Roman Catholic clergy. A mortarboard is now a symbol. The red square, yeah, these are squares. Here's the Pope bowing before a mafia. Yeah, you got to ask yourself, how come the Pope has to bow to get the square on his head? You better check this out and figure out, why does the Pope have to bow to politicians? The square, the red square. Isn't that what where Russia was, the Moscow was ruled from? The red square? The red square. You find that in the Vatican, the red square. The Nazis used the red square. I mean, even Union Bank uses the red square. And incidentally, the Union Bank goes back to Adolf Hitler. Adolf Hitler founded a bank with the gold he got from Jews. He founded a bank called the Reichsstadt All German Union Bank. The Reichsstadt All German Union Bank. Today, the Reichsstadt All German Union Bank is known in our country as Union Bank. Union Bank was founded by Adolf Hitler. But don't take this personal. It's just business. Understand? Yeah, here is a red shield, Rothschild, and what do you see as a symbol of fascism? That here's fascism was an authoritarian political movement. The last sentence, it says, its name was derived from a fasces, a Roman symbol for authority consisting of a bundle of rods and an axe. political life. In most cases, fascists have come to power after a nation has suffered an economic collapse, a military defeat, or some other disaster. The fascist party wins mass support by promising to revive the economy and restore national pride. Say it again. When? Okay. Political life under fascism. In most cases, fascists have come to power after a nation has suffered an economic collapse, a military defeat, or some other disaster. The fascist party wins mass support by promising to revive the economy and restore national pride. Where have we heard this crap before? The people running this country are nothing but the patsies for international fascist Nazism. They are fascist murderers all. And one day, there's going to come a time when the divine justice is going to be having its way on this earth, and people like George Bush and all of the other fascist, Nazi, underworld, mafiosi murderers are going to bite the dust. You can bet on it. God has watched the coming and going of Hitler's for thousands of years, and it hasn't impressed him a bit. And the people that are running this government today, they're on their way out too, very soon. Personal liberty is severely limited under a fascist government. Here is a fascist. You'll see it underneath. It's everywhere throughout the world, especially in South America, Italy again, Benito Mussolini. You'll see the fascist. Fascism of Italian domination. Here's Kurt Waldheim, fascist Nazi, ended up being the head of the United Nations. I don't know what that tells you about the UN. And here's the Pope with his fascist Nazi friend. Both of them are grinning because they both know what they're doing, and they know you don't know what they're doing. And that's why they're both smiling. I put the Pope in the same place with Adolf Hitler and the other fascist Nazis. I know. I've done 42 years of research on the Roman system of fascism, Nazism, and I can tell you the papacy is the bottom line if you want to talk about fascism. Why does the Pope wear a Jewish yarmulke? You ever thought about that? Where's the Jewish yarmulke? Why? Here at the Vatican, Cardinal Pacelli, who later became Pope Pius XII, he signs a concordance. Eugenio Pacelli, now Vatican Secretary of State, presides over the signing of a concordat between Germany and the Vatican in 1933. The Vatican signed contracts with the Nazis. There were two of them. They were called concordances. Now, how many people know that? The Pope signs contracts with Adolf Hitler. Here's Benito Mussolini in the Vatican signing contracts with the Vatican. Again, here's another cardinal meeting with all of the fascists on the left. Here are the priests heiling Hitler. Here's Pacelli. Now here's the Cardinal Nuncio. Papal Nuncio in Germany talking to Adolf Hitler. Again, the fasci. Here it is on American coins, the fasci. Here it is in Rome. Take a good look at the fasci on that symbol. Here it is in America. Here it is on the American dime. It's a traditional symbol of republicanism, a fasci as its symbol. Yeah, Republicans have always used the fasci because they crawl on their knees before the Pope and the Mafia. You see on both sides of the podium, fasces. That's a fasces. And you'll see it with the president and on both sides of the podium. We can have the lights now.
I learned much from the Order of the Jesuits. Until now, there has never been anything more grandiose on the earth than the hierarchical organization of the Catholic Church. I transferred much of this organization into my own party. I am going to let you in on a secret. I am founding an order. In my burghs of the order, we will raise up a youth which will make the world tremble.
July 1897. Hitler enrolled in a monastery's choir and school. Adolf continues to do well, achieving the Austrian equivalent of straight A's. He will later recall, "Since my free time, I have received singing lessons in the cloister at Lambach. I had excellent opportunity to intoxicate myself with the solemn splendor of the brilliant church festivals. It seemed to me perfectly natural to regard the abbot as the highest and most desirable ideal, just as my father regarded the village priest as his ideal. May 22, 1904. 15-year-old Adolf Hitler is confirmed a Roman Catholic at Linz Cathedral, sponsored by one of his father's pallbearers and former customs house colleague. Adolf Hitler, son of the Catholic Church, died while defending Christianity. It is therefore understandable that words cannot be found to lament over his death. When so many were found to exalt his life, over his mortal remains stands his victorious moral figure. With the palm of the martyr, God gives Hitler the laurels of victory. Spanish dictator Francisco Franco, Knight of the Order of Christ, published on the 3rd of May, 1945, the day of Hitler's death. The Führer had come to power thanks to the votes of the Catholic Zentrum only 5 years before. But most of the objectives cynically revealed in Mein Kampf are already realized. This book of insolent challenge to the Western democracies was written by the Jesuit Father Stampf and signed by Hitler. For, as so many ignore the fact, it was the Society of Jesus which perfected the famous Pan-German program as laid out in this book, and the Führer endorsed it. The Secret History of the Jesuits, page 138. On 30 January 1933, Adolf Hitler was appointed Chancellor. On 23 March 1933, his government was given legislative powers through the Enabling Act and was passed by all Reichstag except for the Social Democrats and Communists, whose deputies had already been arrested. Hitler had obtained the votes of the Center Party, led by Prelate Ludwig Kass, by issuing oral guarantees of the party's continued existence and the autonomy of the church and her educational institutions. He also promised good relations with the Holy See, which some interpret as the hint of a future concordat. Born in Trier, Kass was ordained a priest in 1906 and studied history and canon law in Trier and Rome. 1906, he completed a doctorate in theology, and in 1909, he obtained a second doctorate in philosophy. In 1910, he was appointed rector of an orphanage and boarding school near Koblenz. Until 1933, he devoted his spare time to scholarly pursuits. Later, Kass would frequently travel to Rome, where he would stay with Pacelli, and he experienced firsthand the new ladder entry, which he published on. In 1931 and 1932, continued as an advisor in negotiations for the Reich Concordat. That, however, came to nothing until 1933. 1933, on 15 March, Kass was the main advocate supporting the Hitler administration's Enabling Act in return for certain constitutional and allegedly ecclesiastic guarantees. Hitler responded positively via Franz von Papen. 23 March, Kass gave a speech outside Reichstag, voicing the center's support for the bill amid concerns put aside. This vote for the Enabling Act was a major step in the institution of the dictatorship of Adolf Hitler and is remembered as the prime example of a democracy voting for its own demise. Because of Kass's request for guarantees and because of his later involvement in the Reich Concordat negotiations, Kass and Papen traveled together to Rome and had discussions on the train. Von Papen assured Kass that a concordat with the new government was a sure thing. Kass had worked on the Reich Concordat for over 10 years. Now, Hitler was offering. The liberal Social Democrats fiercely opposed the Enabling Act. Hitler needed a two-thirds majority, so the balance lay with the Zentrum, the Catholic Party. Zentrum leader Monsignor Ludwig Kass, a close friend and advisor to Eugenio Pacelli, the future Pope Pius XII, addressed the Reichstag. Far from attacking the Enabling Act or disputing Hitler's claim that Nazism was based on Christianity, Kass called for a yes vote. The Zentrum faction did vote yes, and the act became law, according to the National Catholic Reporter correspondent John Allen. Cass acted in coordination with the German bishops. 4 days later, on March 28, the German bishops rescinded their ban on Nazi Party membership. On April 1st, Cardinal Adolf Bertram of Breslau addressed German Catholics in a letter warning them to reject as a matter of principle all illegal and subversive activities. To most Catholics, it looked as if the Church wanted a modus vivendi with Hitler. The same impression was created a few weeks later when Hitler held a plebiscite to endorse the decision to pull Germany out of the League of Nations, which received the endorsement of the Catholic press and several Catholic bishops. When Hitler and the Church came to terms for a concordat, it cemented the impression that Hitler was a man of the Church, which the Church could do business with.
Signing the Concordat is Cardinal Pacelli, later to become Pope Pius XII. By 1933, he was the Vatican Secretary of State. Far left is Prelate Ludwig Cass, leader of the Center Party. Seated second from his left is Franz von Papen, who was a German nobleman, Catholic politician, general staff officer and diplomat, who served as Chancellor of Germany in 1932. Standing at the far right can be seen the little-known Vatican prelate, Montini, later to become Pope Paul VI.
At a time when the heads of the major nations in the world faced the new Germany with cool reserve and considerable suspicion, the Catholic Church, the greatest moral power on earth, through the Concordat expressed its confidence in the new German government. There was religious freedom for Catholics during Nazi Germany per the terms of the Concordat between the Holy See and the German Reich. Article 1, the German Reich guarantees freedom of profession and public practice of the Catholic religion.
Another well-informed person, the mainspring of the pact between the Holy See and Berlin and the Pope's secret chamberlain, Franz von Papen, was even more explicit. The Third Reich is the first world power which not only acknowledges but also puts into practice the high principles of the papacy. To this we will add the results of this putting into practice of the high principles of the papacy. 25 million victims of the concentration camps, the official figure issued by the United Nations.
Secret History of the Jesuits, page 164. Pope Benedict XVI, current pope when he was in the Hitler Youth.
His father, Joseph Ratzinger Sr., was an Ordnungspolizei, also known as Orpo. The Orpo was the name for the uniformed regular German police force that existed in Nazi Germany between the years of 1936 and 1945. After their green uniforms, they were also referred to as Grüne Polizei, Green Police. Joseph Ratzinger Sr. served in the Bavarian Landespolizei for several years as a rural policeman. Various sources state that the Ratzinger's views toward the National Socialist German Workers' Party caused the family some hardship, including the family having to move several times in the 1930s. There is no evidence, however, that Joseph Ratzinger Sr. was ever arrested for anti-Nazi tendencies. He continued to serve in the police even after such events as the Night of the Long Knives and the passing of the Nuremberg Laws. In 1936, Joseph Ratzinger Sr. became a member of the Orpo after all the police forces of Nazi Germany were incorporated into a national police force.
Here are some pictures of Dominican monks serving meals to Nazis. You can see how this could play a role in the conscience of the Nazi. The religion he grew up in was supporting their fascism. Who is more evil? The Roman Catholic Church, of course, although the Nazis are not by any means innocent. The Inquisition was suggested by Dominic de Guzman and was begun in 1204. It was hell's masterpiece of cunning, perfidy, cruelty, and all-around wickedness. It was conducted with the rankest injustice. The victim was dragged into court without witness and without any information as to what the charge against him. He was not allowed an attorney or the presence of friends, but under the cruelest torture it was demanded that he recant his heresies, oftentimes not knowing what the item in charge of which he was to recant. Hitler, Goebbels, Himmler, and most members of the party's old guard were Catholics, wrote M. Frederick Hoffet. It was not by accident that, because of its chief religion, the National Socialist Government was the most Catholic Germany ever had. This kinship between National Socialism and Catholicism is most striking if we study closely the propaganda methods and the interior organization of the party. On that subject, nothing is more instructive than Joseph Goebbels' works. He had been brought up in a Jesuit college and was a seminarist before devoting himself to literature and politics. Every page, every line of his writings recall the teaching of his masters. So he stresses obedience and contempt for truth. Some lies are as useful as bread, he proclaimed with virtue of moral relativism, extracted from Ignatius of Loyola's writings.
Joseph Goebbels. He was Nazi member of the Reichstag from 1928 to 1933. Reich Minister of Enlightenment and Propaganda from 1933 to 1945. Reich Commissioner for Total Mobilization from 1944 to 1945. On May 1, 1945, he poisoned his 6 children, then shot his wife and killed himself to escape the advancing Allied armies. Joseph Goebbels was born into a strict Catholic working-class family from Reit in the Rhineland on October 29, 1897. He was educated at a Roman Catholic school and went on to study history and literature at the University of Heidelberg. Goebbels was exempted from military service during World War I because of a crippled foot, the result of contracting polio as a child. Joseph Goebbels' wife Magda, whose Jewish father died at the Buchenwald slave labor camp, and the 6 children whom they killed before killing themselves. The eldest son in uniform by Magda's previous marriage was in the Luftwaffe and survived the war. Goebbels was so close to fellow Catholic Hitler that he had him serve as first witness at his Catholic marriage. Heinrich Himmler. The son of a pious, authoritarian Roman Catholic schoolmaster who had once been tutor to the Bavarian Crown Prince. His mother, Anna Maria Himmler, maiden name Hader, was also a devout Catholic. Kurt Heinrich Himmler, Reichsfuhrer of the SS, Gestapo, and German police forces, seemed to be one of the most impregnated by clericalism amongst the Catholic members of Hitler's entourage. His father had been director of a Catholic school in Munich, then tutor of Prince Ruprecht of Bavaria. His brother, a Benedictine monk, lived at the monastery of Maria Lach, one of the pan-German high places. He also had an uncle, Jesuit Himmler, who had held the important position of canon at the court of Bavaria. The German author Walter Hagen gives also this discreet information. The Jesuits general, Count Halk von Leduchowski, was ready to organize, on the common basis of anti-communism, some collaboration between the German Secret Service and the Jesuit Order. As a result, within the SS Central Security Service, an organization was created, and most of its main posts were held by Catholic priests wearing the black uniform of the SS. The Jesuit Father Himmler was one of its superior officers. After the Third Reich's capitulation, the Jesuit Father Himmler was arrested and imprisoned at Nuremberg. His hearing by the International Tribunal would have apparently been most interesting, but Providence was keeping a watchful eye. Heinrich Himmler's uncle never appeared before that court. One morning, he was found dead in his cell, and the public never learned the cause of his death. Another highly placed Nazi, Walter Schellenberg, former chief of the German counter-espionage, completed this confidence from the Führer after the war. The SS organization had been constituted by Himmler according to the principles of the Jesuits' order. Their regulations and the spiritual exercises prescribed by Ignatius of Loyola were the model Himmler tried to copy exactly. The Reichsfuhrer SS, Himmler's title as supreme chief of the SS, was to be the equivalent of the Jesuits' general, and the whole structure of the direction was a close imitation of the Catholic Church's hierarchical order. A medieval castle near Paderborn in Westphalia, and called Wevelsburg, was restored. It became what could be called an SS monastery.
Rita. lost all my game. You have behind me to the screen so that you don't have to be seen. How could a person be so mean?
Who are you? And what do you do that makes you think you're above me? But have you walked in my shoes?
Cause you're a hanger on. You think you got me figured out. Never made me have no clue what I'm about. Maybe I got things you wish you had. You need to stop hating, get a pen and a pen. I walk around the clock, so fill your mouth up with a sock and get your head up, I'll catch ya.
Tell me who you are and what your background is. Tell me how you're feeling when you listen to this.
Who
are you? What do you do that makes you think you're above me? But have you walked in my shoes? The pedestal you put yourself on. No sense I'm breaking it down now. It's gone, collapsing.
Bei der Kaserne vor dem großen Tor steht ne Laterne und steht sie noch davor. Da wollen wir uns wiedersehen, bei der Laterne wollen wir stehen, wie einst Lili Marlene, wie einst Lili Marlene. Unsere beiden Schatten sahen wie ein aus, dass wir lieb uns hatten, das sah man gleich daraus. Und alle Leute sollen es sehen, wenn wir bei der Laterne stehen, wie einst Lili Marlene, wie einst Lili Marlene. Deine Schritte kennt sie, deinen schönen Gang. Alle Abend brennt sie, doch mich vergaß sie lang. Und sollte mir ein Leid geschehen, wer wird bei der Laterne steht, mit dir, Lili Marleen, mit dir, Lili Marleen. Aus dem tiefen Raume, aus der Grund, hebt sich wie im Traume dein verliebter Mund. Wenn sich die späten Nebel drehen, wer wird bei dir Laterne stehen, mit dir, Lili Marleen, mit dir, Lili Marleen. Wenn sich die späten Nebel drehen, wer wird bei dir Laterne stehen, mit dir, Lili Marleen, mit dir, Lili Marleen.
Thank you.